online lottery, beating out more than 1.5 million who also tried. An overflow crowd of more than 6,500, meanwhile, will be watching across the way on a widescreen video screen at the Nokia Theater. And all over the world, people are watching on television and in theaters. What they and we will all see includes performances by Stevie Wonder, Mariah Carey, Usher, Lionel Richie, Kobe Bryant, Jennifer Hudson, John Mayer, and Queen Latifah. Many other celebrities will be in attendance, but also of note, who we won't see. Michael Jackson's good friend Elizabeth Taylor, who used Twitter yesterday to say, quote, she can't be part of the public hoopla, end quote. And she also said he would understand her feelings because she didn't want to share her grief with millions of people. Also absent today, Beyonce, Justin Timberlake, as well as Jackson's ex-wives, Lisa Marie Presley and Debbie Rowe, who said she didn't want to distract from the service. Let's go to Bill Whitaker, who is standing by at Forest Lawn Cemetery in the Hollywood Hills. Bill, tell us what transpired there already this morning.
Good morning, Katie. The Jackson family held its private service here just a short while ago. It was a relatively short service, about an hour, before they headed downtown for the big public tribute at the Staples Center. But here at Forest Lawn was the family's time, away from the spotlight, to say their final quiet farewell. It was before 8 this morning when the funeral cortege left Jackson's parents' home in Encino under the watchful eye of fans and police, making its way to the Hall of Liberty here at Forest Lawn. Last night, a casket believed to be Jackson's was delivered to the hall. An intimate group of family and friends gathered here, among them Michael Jackson's sister Latoya and brother Randy. They were back again today, this time with Jackson's parents, children, and other family and friends for a final private service. Many entertainment luminaries are buried here at this Hollywood Hills final resting place, including Mae West and Betty Davis, Stan Laurel and Sammy Davis, Liberace, Lucille Ball, and just recently, Ed McMahon. Now, before Michael Jackson is buried here, his body goes downtown to the big tribute, the big public tribute at the Staples Center. Now, the cortege departed the cemetery about a half hour ago. Limousines, private cars, 37 in all, with a huge police escort going along the freeways here of Los Angeles to the tribute downtown. But now the private service is over, and Michael Jackson once again is delivered to his public. Katie?
And Bill, this, of course, is all happening under a cloud of some legal troubles and legal wrangling about the Michael Jackson estate as well as custody of his children. Can you explain sort of what's going on there, Bill?
Well, we know that the battle over the children could be a pretty brutal one. We've got Michael Jackson saying that he wants his mother to take care of his children, and now Debbie Rowe, the mother of the older two of the three children, says she might want to take custody, so that will end up in court. We've also got the will that's going to be managed by two of his former business partners. Yesterday in court, the judge took the administration of his estate away from his mother and gave it to these two business partners, and they will now be able to handle his money, which will be even bigger in the future based on the money that will come in from his name, his signature, and his image down the line. Katie?
Right. And I know there's a hearing about his estate, Bill, in August, and the first of the child custody hearings will be happening next Monday. So it should be very interesting to watch. Bill Whitaker at Forest Lawn Cemetery. Bill, thank you so much. Let's go to Ben Tracy now. Ben is here near me on the periphery of the Staples Center with some of the throngs of people who have gathered here to be part of this moment in history. Ben, what's going on there?
Well, that's right, Katie. We're a long city block from the Staples Center, and back here, this is what the police are calling the cold zone. These are all the people that came down here without tickets simply because they wanted to be a part of this event. And some people came from a long ways away, including Vernice over here. Vernice, you came from New York City, is that right?
I came from the Bronx, New York, Brian. I came a long way to see Michael, to say goodbye.
And you told me your ticket cost about $900, so you are a big fan. Why do you want to be here so badly?
Well, you know, I've always been a fan, I've never seen him since 1978, and now here we are in 2009. I've never gone to a concert because of the crowds, but I had to get down here to say goodbye to him and his family, and, you know, he's just gone too soon. He's an icon, the king of pop. I just had to be here. My family sent me. I'm here on Facebook and everything, on the telephone with my people from New York. People from the Bronx, I love you. Thanks, Mom, for helping me get out here.
Now, it's highly unlikely you're going to be able to see a whole lot of anything. What would make your day?
I would just die if I saw a limo or a glove or just anything. I mean, we were sitting out here early. I've been here since 7 o'clock this morning. I slept on the floor. My friend's in Woolen Hills. I leave tomorrow going back to work.
Well, thank you so much, and hopefully you'll get to see something. Katie, as you can tell, there's a lot of energy out here, a lot of people very excited to simply be a part of this day in history.
But, Ben, are they frustrated that they're here, but they can't? Are they frustrated that they're here, but can't necessarily see the service itself?
Yeah, I don't know if frustration's the right word, because I think they expected they weren't going to be able to see a whole lot. The police have been very clear, telling people, don't come down here because you're not going to see much. But obviously, there are a lot of people who simply want to be here in the general area. For them, that's experience enough.
All right, Ben Tracy. Ben, thanks so much. Jeff Glor, meanwhile, is covering the law enforcement and security aspect of this monumental event. And Jeff, this is obviously presenting a lot of security, safety, and financial challenges to the city of Los Angeles.
Yeah, Katie, financial challenges at exactly the wrong time right now. Here's the way this works. AEG, the concert promoter and the company organizing this service, has agreed to pay for everything inside the Staples Center and on Staples Center property. However, everything outside on surrounding streets has to be handled by the city. That means police, fire, sanitation, general city services, barricades, all paid for by a city that is $500 million in debt right now. They're estimating this whole thing will cost between $2 and $4 million. So basically, the city of Los Angeles is spending money on this service that they don't have. And so they've appealed to the Jackson family, also to AEG, the promoter, to try to pick up some of these costs. So far as we know, they have not gotten a response. The city then has gone ahead and set up a website soliciting donations from the public. They're hoping that a lot of little donations will add up to a lot of money. Katie, back to you.
All right, Jeff Glor, thanks very much. Now, watching along with me, our journalist Randy Tabarelli, who Randy's written many biographies of celebrities, including Michael Jackson, The Magic and the Madness, and a 10-time Grammy winner, music producer Kenny Babyface Edmonds, who knew Michael Jackson well and collaborated with him on a number of projects throughout his career. Gentlemen, thanks so much for being here with us. Nice to see you both.
It's good to be.
Kenny, you first met Michael Jackson, and you knew him really through his whole life, practically. But you first met him when you were in eighth grade. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I was from Indiana, and the Jackson 5 came into the city, and I wanted to meet him so bad, so I pretended to be a journalist and called the promoter and said that I was Mr. Clayton, and I wanted these kids to interview kids, and I got in there, and the first time I met Michael, we were both 12, 13 years old, and I interviewed him, and at that time he was much shorter. I was towering over him. Somewhere he got taller than me. I don't know how that happened, but it was amazing to meet him way back then.
And you forged a friendship and a working relationship throughout your career. You collaborated on a number of songs with Michael Jackson,
yes,
produced
ma'am.
A number of songs, and tell us, you knew him quite well personally. You spent a lot of private time with him. You know, he's such an enigma in many ways, Kenny. How would you describe him?
Michael was a really good guy. I would notice that a lot of people that would meet Michael, there was a certain kind of magic that would happen when you would actually meet him. And even those that may be questionable about him, once you meet him, it goes away. He had this magic quality about him. And he was a very silly guy. He did jokes all the time. he laughed at me all the time. I don't know why exactly, but I walk in the room, he just started laughing. And he said it was that Indiana thing, Indiana.
Because you're from Indiana. Exactly. You're one of six brothers, so yes. You must have related to him. You're 51 years old.
Yes.
He was 50, sadly, yeah. When he passed away. So, you know, and he was in every way a contemporary, really.
I think Michael, I wouldn't call myself, put myself on the same level as Michael. I don't know that anyone can. Michael came into this world as a kid next door that we all saw get on that stage and miracles happened when he hit that stage. And from that point on, it was an amazing thing.
Let's just go inside the Staples Center because Smokey Robinson is speaking, and then we'll be able to talk some more.
Michael wanted me to be there for his children, and I will be there if they ever need me. I hope today brings closure for all those who loved him. Thank you, Catherine and Joe, for sharing your son with the world and with me. I send my love and condolences to the Jackson family. Diana Ross. Dear Jackson family, it is with great sadness that we learned of the untimely death of Michael Jackson. Michael became close to us after he started visiting and performing in South Africa regularly. We grew fond of him, and he became a close member of our family. We had great admiration for his talent and that he was able to triumph over tragedy on so many occasions in his life. Michael was a giant and a legend in the music industry, and we mourn with the millions of fans worldwide. We also mourn with his family and his friends over the loss of our dear friend. He will be missed, and memories about him cherished for a very long time. My wife and I, our family, our friends, send you our condolences during this time of mourning. Be strong. Nelson Mandela.
Randy, tell us a little bit about the arrangements for this really huge spectacle of a memorial service. Did things run smoothly? Was there a lot of infighting? There seems to have been a fair amount of chaos surrounding the planning of this, which may be expected given his untimely death and the speed at which they had to plan this.
Well, you know, Kenny and I were just talking about the fact that Michael would have loved this. This is the kind of major event that Michael would have wanted. And of course, there's always chaos when you put together something like this very quickly. You know, but I think what we've seen out here is a lot of respect. This has been a very well-behaved crowd. It's a big crowd. I've never seen anything quite like this, maybe since the Victory Tour, you know. And it seems to be very orderly, and I think that this has been very well put together considering the amount of time that they had to orchestrate this.
Tell us a little bit about the comeback tour that he was planning in London. There seems to have been a lot of excitement surrounding that. Was he excited? Did he feel responsible, obligated? Do you know how he was looking toward that event?
Well, you know, that event actually started because Michael really wanted to perform for his children. That was sort of the original idea of that event. You know, Michael said that while he's young enough to be able to do it, and his children are old enough to be able to enjoy it, he wanted to be able to perform for his kids. And then it kind of blew up from there and became a major event, as everything involving Michael Jackson eventually did. And he became very excited about the prospect of going out there and doing what he did so well. And he, you know, we've seen the footage, the rehearsal footage of Michael right here at the Staples Center when he was rehearsing 2 days before his death. And wow, I mean, Kenny, you look great.
You look great.
You look great. I mean, it really looked like Michael Jackson was on his way, you know, to coming back and being strong, in his field again. So I think it was going to be a very interesting and maybe very good comeback.
And Kenny, you told me earlier this morning that Michael Jackson always wanted to talk about the work, never stopped trying to do his best in whatever enterprise he was involved in.
It had to be the best, and I think sometimes that's why he would put so much money into things, because it couldn't be anything but the best. And so whatever it took, whatever you had to do to make it the best thing, as we said, this event right here, the fact how it's come out and how everyone has come out to support and all the love that's happening, this is kind of the best for him. You know, he would look at this, this is amazing, that's how he would want it. And I'm sure he was preparing for this tour in the same way. He was ready to go. And as we saw, you know, I don't know if you can even call it a comeback, because all he ever had to do was walk on the stage. And once he walks on the stage, then that's it. You know, we just haven't seen him on the stage.
Once he walks on the stage, that's the comeback.
It's not a comeback. He's just back.
He was. You told me also that you rode with him in a car to a gig once. I guess you wouldn't really call it a gig, would you, Kenny? But to a concert.
Yeah.
And what that was like. Tell us about that.
It was amazing. It was in Nice, France, and he called me over, and I went over and rode in the car with him, with me and my son at the time, who's 13, he will be 13 at this point. And so he was just basically 1 or 2 years old. And we sat in the car and we're riding, and all the fans were just banging on the doors. And as it was kind of scary, actually. And as we went through the concert, I stayed in the dressing room off to the side. He wouldn't let me leave. He just let me stay. He wanted me to stay there and experience the whole thing of being Michael. And it was an amazing thing. And at that point, I got to see how hard he works. He works hard every bit of the way. He was no slouch as an entertainer at all.
Having said that, before we continue our conversation, I just want to show folks at home watching, we just got this program for the memorial service, which obviously had to be done quickly, but it obviously features many photographs of Michael Jackson that all those in attendance will be receiving. Needless to say, this is going to become quite a collector's item, I'm sure. But, you know, we look at him from his early days on. And Randy and Kenny, I was just curious. Kenny just talked about all the fans. How was he able to deal with this superstardom? And do you think that in many ways contributed to some pretty obvious problems he had later in his life in terms of just all the scrutiny, all the attention, all the stardom?
I remember talking to Michael about that back in the early 1980s when Thriller was becoming the biggest album of all time. And I have to tell you, you know, he really was not prepared for the kind of worldwide attention that he received. Michael just wasn't wired that way. You know, if it had been up to Michael, he would have had a much more private life. He wanted to make great music, and he wanted to be number one. But paradoxically, he didn't want the kind of attention that went with that status. And it was difficult for him. I talked to him many times about that over the years, and he had a tough time adjusting, especially when the tabloids began to really create stories about him that he thought were unfair. That was really hard for him, and I don't think he ever really adjusted to it, no.
What about you, Kenny? I mean, I know that you told me he was always talking to you about the music when the two of you would get together. I mean, clearly that's what drove him, his artistry and his desire to perform. He said many times what it was like to be on stage, and I think he did become a different person when he set foot on that stage. But did he confide in you at all about what it was like and trying to maintain? I mean, it's one thing to reach superstardom, but then to try to maintain it is really difficult.
It was difficult, but the one thing that was certain is that Michael loved his fans. And so he didn't like the press and how they would jump on him. But in terms of his love for the fans, that's what pushed him. Because when he would walk out on that stage and he'd feel that was the thing that kept him going more than anything. And once you feel that, you know, it's an amazing thing just for me to stand to the off to the side of the stage and see and feel that love. That was, I think, what ultimately pushed him. And obviously, you know, his kids, that's a whole nother thing. In his family life, that was a whole nother thing. That was precious. That was a world that he wanted no one to tamper with whatsoever.
He was a very loving father. Did you see him with his children?
Only a couple times. And he always kind of kept his family, you know, kept it separate. And because he wanted to protect them more than anything.
Well, you know, he knew what he'd been through as a youngster, yeah. You know, with the Jackson 5. I mean, and I was there for the Jackson 5 days, but I was backstage at some of those Jackson 5 shows when we were kids. And it was chaos, and, you know, and Michael had a tough time even as a young. I remember them having to carry Michael on an airplane kicking and screaming when he was about 12 because he didn't want to fly. You know, I mean, he had a lot of traumatic experiences as a young kid. So he worked very hard to protect his kids from any kind of exposure that they would have bad memories of when they were adults.
Let's go to Mark Phillips because he's covering this event from London, of course, where Michael's series of concerts was scheduled for actually early July. And Mark, tell us are people very cognizant of this memorial service over in London? Are people paying much attention to it?
They're absolutely aware of it. This is, as you say, the place where the comeback of Michael Jackson was due to begin just next week. And so it's a place that feels that it has a connection to him, those 50 concerts that so much has already been said about that were planned. Excuse me. We're here right in the, keep going. We're here right in the center of London and in front of what has become one of the many shrines, places of tribute for Michael Jackson. There's one here, there's one around the corner, there's one around the corner on one of London's main squares. People have gathered, in fact, not only all over London, but right around the world in anticipation of this memorial and to pay their respects, as they have been doing, laying flowers, leaving these tributes over the past week. This is not just an LA event and not just an American event. It's very much a worldwide wake, a new WWW, I suppose. And it's one that's being paid attention to right across the planet. It's being carried live. I think it's in something like 180 countries, and that doesn't count the internet saturation that it will have as well. There's a prospective audience being predicted in the 300 million range. It's likely to begin to be the biggest memorial service the world, in fact, has ever seen. Katie.
All right, Mark Phillips. Mark Phillips, thanks very much. Meanwhile, Michelle Miller is in Harlem, where there have been many celebrations of Michael Jackson's life. Michelle, what's going on there?
Well, many people here say if they couldn't be in Los Angeles at the memorial service, this is where they wanted to be, in the heart of Harlem, about a block away from the Apollo Theater, where Michael Jackson burst onto the music scene, where less than a week ago he was his life was celebrated, where thousands gathered. And today, take a look, there are 500 to 600 people, a steady stream of folks who are standing before this jumbotron, enwrapped, watching what is taking place in Los Angeles. They say that they wanted to share this moment in time with people who understood what they were going through. These are fans far and wide, all ages, all races. They wanted folks to be here with other people who grew up with Michael Jackson. Now, many here wanted to be in Los Angeles, but quite frankly, they were barred from participating in the lottery. New York State, Rhode Island, and Florida barred their residents from participating in that lottery. So they're here, they're sharing one moment in time they say they will never forget. Katie?
All right, Michelle Miller. Michelle, thanks so much, and maybe we'll come back to you, and you can talk to some of those fans who have gathered while we wait for the memorial service to continue. Oddly enough, Smokey Robinson spoke a few minutes ago. He read a message from Diana Ross, who apparently is not in attendance, and also from Nelson Mandela. And as you can see inside the Staples Center, we're waiting for the rest of the memorial service to begin. And as we wait, let's go to Ben Tracy once more, who is outside the Staples Center, where many, many fans have gathered. They do not have tickets. They do not have a jumbotron. Tron, but they wanted to be a part of this moment in pop culture history. Ben, tell us, maybe you can talk to a few more people who have gathered here this morning.
Exactly. You know, Katie, early on, the police feared that there could be as many as a million people descending on downtown Los Angeles. Then they ratcheted that down to about a couple hundred thousand. Now they're saying it could be 50,000. When you look back here at the crowd, it looks like a big crowd, but we think there's probably only about 500 people here at this particular barricade, but there are barricades like this all around the perimeter down here. And as you said, these are people who don't have tickets. These are people who simply came here because they wanted to be part of this event to help celebrate Michael Jackson. And let me show you why things seem to be going pretty smoothly down here. You can see there is a significant police presence. We're told 3,200 police officers are deployed in and around the Staples Center. That is a larger police contingent than they had during the 84 Olympics that were held here in Los Angeles. So they're clearly hoping that these crowds will just be here, have fun, trying to participate in the event. But they're right now, they're not expecting any problems. Katie?
All right, Ben Tracy. Ben, thanks very much. Let's go to Sandra Hughes. She is outside the Neverland Ranch, of course, Michael Jackson's beloved home for a period of time. And Sandra, I know there had been some discussion about possibly burying Michael Jackson at the Neverland Ranch, sort of turning it into a Graceland type location, but that didn't happen, and that was because it was prohibited by law. Is that right?
Well, what there was talk about was actually burying him here, and that's against California law, unless a person is cremated. You know, I've talked to several of the fans who are gathered here this morning. In fact, I'm going to just step back a little bit and show you. We've got quite a crowd that is amassing here in front of the gates of Neverland. We've got quite a few vendors who are here as well. They're selling everything from these Michael Jackson t-shirts to hats to buttons, lemonade, water, you name it. There are quite a few entrepreneurs here. You know, Katie, the fans that I talked to this morning said they didn't even try to get into that lottery to get a seat down at Staples Center, that they really feel closer to Michael Jackson here at Neverland Ranch. You know, he purchased this ranch when he was 29 years old back in 1988, and he spent millions of dollars to just turn it into this amazing childlike fantasy amusement park. It had circus animals, they had amusement rides, it had two trains, one of them a steam engine, an ice cream machine that we're told Katie was kept on all the time, just in case children would stop by. He invited children from the town of Los Olivos, right down the road. There's a school across the street. He would invite children from there to come spend a day at Neverland. You know, the name even coming from the fantasy island in Peter Pan, where children never grow up. And many people saying that Michael Jackson was trying to recapture some of his youth here. And, you know, quite frankly, some of the fans that I'm talking to today say they still expect that there's going to be some kind of a ceremony up here in memorial to Michael Jackson. Katie?
All right, Sandra Hughes, thank you so much. Randy Taraborelli, let's talk a little bit about Michael Jackson's estate. He was terribly in debt, and yet his estate is estimated to be at what, $500 million?
Yes, Katie, we're talking a $500 million in Michael Jackson's estate. He is said to be about $300 million in debt, which still leaves you know, quite a sizable amount. It's interesting that when Michael Jackson hired the lawyer who is the executor of his present will, John Branca, back in 1980, he was worth $1 million. And so you can imagine, you know, how much money he's accumulated over the years. He was a very shrewd businessman, Michael was. You know, most of that has to do with the ATV catalog, which is the Beatles catalog that we've heard so much about, that Michael is a 50% owner in. And so, you know, it's going to be interesting now to see how the estate plays out, you know, as they try to settle all of the bills that Michael has left behind.
What about what he's likely to make in debt? I mean, I read somewhere that Elvis Presley's estate made $53 million last year. I don't know if that's possible, but it's likely to be a huge money-making venture, is it not?
There's no doubt about it. I mean, most icons, when they pass away, such as, you know, when Marilyn Monroe died, she died practically with no money at all. and her estate is, you know, is worth a lot of money today. And many people have asked me, do you think Michael Jackson is worth more in death than in life? You know, and I just don't believe that that's the case. Michael Jackson would have made hundreds of millions of dollars on his present tour if it had continued as they intended it to. I mean, Michael Jackson was in the prime of his life. Don't you agree, Kenny?
Yeah.
I mean, he was going to make a lot of money, and he had an amazing future ahead of him. That said, yes, the estate will definitely prosper.
Why do you think he had an amazing future ahead of him? One hopes that is the case, Randy, but clearly he was having a lot of medical issues. We are waiting for the toxicology reports. There was Diprivan apparently found, which is a powerful anesthesia, which is only used during procedures, and when it is extremely carefully monitored.
Yes.
And obviously he seemed to be quite frail. So why are you so confident that some of his best days were still ahead?
You know, because after the trial, Katie, after the trial in Santa Maria, you know, that sort of fire in his belly had been extinguished, and it had been such a demoralizing experience for him. And when he was exonerated, it took him years to sort of get over the traumatic experience of the trial. And I know from my sources inside the family that in the last year, he had just sort of come to a point where he was ready to go on and perform and record and do the kinds of things that he's been known to do. Now, as for the, you know, the drugs and all of that, I mean, I want to wait for the toxicology report to come in before, you know, I want to comment on that. I'm hoping, like Jermaine and I talked about this, I mean, I'm hoping, you know, that none of that's the case. We'll find out when those reports come in, and that would be very interesting.
How much you mentioned that the trials really were very demoralizing for him. On the other hand, there's still many people in this country, as you well know, Randy, who think that Michael Jackson was involved in inappropriate and illegal behavior.
Well, I sat in that courtroom every single day right behind Michael Jackson, and I listened to the evidence, and I have to say that I wasn't convinced, and that was, you know, my opinion.